fixes his gaze on the eyes of the Tigers. You're watching the American Conference, and today a top 25 Memphis team comes to Philadelphia to take on the Temple Owls. It's two of the best teams in the American Conference and a potential conference championship preview. In the brief history of the American Conference, this is the best and deepest the league has been. Three teams in the top 25, and it is wide open with Temple and Memphis still having a shot at division titles and a conference championship. Anish Shroff alongside Ahmad Brooks. We'll hear from Chris Budden in a bit. This game is a showcase for two of the best young running backs in the country.
Well, I think when you leave this game, you're going to remember the names Ramon Davis and Kenneth Gainwell. They're both special players. And the one thing that stands out to me when I watch them on film, oftentimes young players tend to push the play rather than to be patient. These two guys have exactly that. But they're also playmakers. On the left, Gainwell, he'll take it to the house. He's got home run speed. And on the opposite side, Ramon Davis will run right through you or around you. Both of these young men are two of the best in the American, if not the best in the country.
Gainwell leading all freshmen in rushing yards. Davis leading all true freshmen in rushing yards. Gainwell, a redshirt freshman. Rod Carey, first season at Temple, coming over after a successful run at Northern Illinois, where he averaged better than 8 wins a season. Temple won the toss. They defer, so Memphis will receive. Jacob LaFree will kick it off. And Antonio Gibson is back deep for Memphis, along with Chris Claybrooks. Claybrooks coming back from injury, making his first appearance of the season. And Memphis will take it out at the 25-yard line. Brady White is the quarterback, and he's become a much better leader this season, Chris Budden.
And last year, having transferred from Arizona State, he is a natural leader, but he was thrust into that role before he even earned the trust from his teammates. He said, it was a little bit awkward. You know, they didn't know me. They didn't know my story. I'm supposed to lead them. He said this year, he told me he's made a point to spend more time over the offseason with his receivers and his teammates. The idea is that they need to learn me in order for them to trust me. And he says it's completely different this year. If you watch on the sidelines, the communication with his team, a complete contrast to last season.
He's been one of the most efficient quarterbacks in the American, leading the league in passer rating. Empty look here on first and 10 from the 25. White screen pass to Kenneth Gainwell, leading the conference in all-purpose yards, and there is the redshirt freshman with a gain of about 8 on first down.
They will use him in a myriad of ways and watch for Memphis to take advantage of the perimeter players versus Temple. They want to force the Temple defense to tackle in space and make it hard on them.
Mike Norvell, fourth season at Memphis, had to replace 7 assistant coaches in the offseason. Wow. Gainwell again, picking up the first down. A week ago, Memphis wasn't sure if Kenneth Gainwell would be healthy enough to play. He didn't start, ran the ball 14 times, and all he did was set a school freshman record with 209 rushing yards.
Oh, it was a great performance.
On the fly sweep, this is Antonio Gibson, who is crunched in the backfield. Quincy Roche leading the charge. When you see those single-digit numbers for Temple, they represent the toughest players on the team.
Well, what you see here already is both of these teams showing their identity, them trying to get the ball to Gainwell in myriad ways, and then this defense running and tackling.
Off play action. Over the middle, that's caught. DeMonte Coxie, and he's close to a first down. 25 straight games with a catch for Coxie.
And I think this is where Brady Wright has really developed his football IQ. He recognized what they were giving him there. He went to the one-on-one opportunity on the backside. Great timing and ball placement.
White toward the sideline. It's broken up, incomplete. Intended for Coxie.
great ball skills there by Harrison Hand. I mean, he's all over this thing. The timing was perfect. He turns around and bats his ball down just in the nick of time. And what you go is you go through those wide receiver hands because they're going to go to the football with their hands. They can't catch it with their face mask or their chest as this Temple defense doing a nice job of forcing a punt here. But I'd be careful here because this is that area, right, where you can run that fake.
Adam Williams has been one of the best punters in the nation. Isaiah Wright, special teams player of the year in the AAC a season ago, signaling for a fair catch and then dives to make it at the 15-yard line.
Wow, that ball just flattened out on him, didn't it? I mean, that was amazing. It was a great punt. Wright, who filled a lot of punts in this field, just wasn't ready for it.
First turn on offense for Temple, and they are led by the redshirt junior, Anthony Russo, 12-3 as a starter. In the win last Thursday against East Carolina, Rod Carey felt Russo got his mojo back. 6'4", 235 with a big arm. He'll move the pocket on first down. He finds Brandon Mack, big 6'5" junior, wrestled out of bounds by Thomas Pickens. He moves the chains. It's a gain of 10.
This is what they want to try to do. They want to try to get Russo more on the move today. And they feel like he's more comfortable in those types of situations. And that fits what Memphis does on defense.
Two tight end look here on first down. This is Jagger Gardner, getting to start at running back today. Fifth-year senior from Black Mountain, North Carolina, just outside of Asheville.
It was a great run. He's got great size on him at 6'2", 220 pounds, and really just swift feet there as he was able to cut and make the first defender miss.
Ray Davis now into the game. Temple's leading rusher. Little pop pass, misdirection, Jaden Blue. Memphis's defense right there. It brings up third and one.
Flag on the play here. Late flag.
Personal foul. Face mask. Defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
Player there, complete. Pickens gets those hands up and actually on the backside. Pardon me. Looks like maybe Austin Hall, number 25 or 23, Russell. Well, that's unfortunate if you're Memphis. And this is a unit, if you're Memphis, they don't get enough credit. They've played some pretty good defense this year.
Much improved on that side. Russo downfield for Mack, who comes down with it inside the 20. Another flag, this one near the 35 of Memphis.
Holding for 40, defense. The penalty is declined. It was over the play, the first down.
You know, I remember watching Mack early on in his career, and with the specs that he has at 6'5", 220, you were just waiting for this day. This is double coverage. They throw right into the teeth of this defense, and he just goes up and steals it from the defenders. I know that makes the coaching staff happy, but it also gives Russo more confidence in him.
Now Ray Davis finds a seam and stumbles inside the 5-yard line, tripped up by TJ Carter.
That was a great run. He's got to lift those legs, you know, because he saw the goal line. It was a nice cut there. He does a wonderful job of disguising himself behind his blockers and then squirting out of there.
Davis coming off back-to-back 100-yard games. Gets the call again. Davis up the middle. He's got a first down, and now Temple with four chances from the one.
He's got a knack for that. You know, it's the shuffling and the moving with his feet as they get back up on the ball. I'm assuming you hand it right back to him.
They do. Davis ran into a roadblock. Thomas Pickens with the stop, and it's second and goal.
And he's just trying to catch Memphis off guard. Memphis was ready for that, and now if they bring in some more size and a tight end and another running back, Gardner enters back into the ballgame. It looked like Davis was a little gimpy on this play. comes off the field limping.
Three tight ends into the game. Gardner, the tailback. The give is to Gardner. Barges into the end zone. And Temple on the board first.
Yeah, they've done a nice job of developing their tight end position. And these are guys that can block. You just get right in behind them. That offensive line getting pushed, particularly from Fair, the left guard, and they punch it in. That was an excellent drive for Temple as they come right out here, and they did everything they wanted to and made that look easy.
Will Mobley stays perfect on PATs. The fifth-year senior with the moves like Jagger.
Nice.
Gardner gets Temple started. Ring the bell, Big Ben. Temple starting fast on homecoming weekend, and that's been a trend all season. They have outscored opponents 42-9 in the first quarter of games. Already one win at home against a top 25 team this season. That was against Maryland.
Temple had not scored in the first quarter in the last two games, and they did what they wanted to in that first drive.
Second offensive series now for Memphis. Brady White, highly regarded quarterback coming out of high school. In fact, he was ranked higher than Drew Locke, Jake Browning, and Sam Darnold coming out of California. Went to Arizona State, where Mike Norvell recruited him, and Norvell was his offensive coordinator with the Sun Devils. Only three games played at ASU. Transferred to Memphis last year after getting his undergraduate degree. Came to the Tigers with 3 years of eligibility and ended up getting his sixth year, so he has one more season for Memphis, a fifth-year junior. They'll hand it off on first down, and nowhere to go that time. Great tackle in space by Harrison Hand. No gain for Gainwell. Kenneth Gainwell coming off three straight 100-yard games. Also a threat in the receiving game. Second on the team with 17 catches. White on the drag route. That's Gainwell changing directions, and he's got a first down. Mike Norvell told us Gainwell is the most naturally gifted athlete he's ever been around.
He also said that if we moved him out to wide receiver, he'd be our best player there. And so this young man is uber talented.
White will keep this little RPO. It's intercepted by Hand. There is a flag down. Hand to the Baylor transfer, but a New Jersey native from nearby Cherry Hill.
Neil, receiver downfield, number 56. Offense, the penalty's declined. The result of the play is interception. First down for Temple.
Oh, man, this is a bad decision. And you listen, great awareness here from Hand. It appeared as though maybe it was a busted play on the back end. It didn't look like White was actually wanting to carry the ball. Either they didn't get communication on the outside as he was trying to go to Coxie for that play. And, I mean, you talk about this is his fourth interception of the year. 11 touchdowns. He's protected the ball fairly well. That time they're making a poor decision. Now putting this hot Temple offense back out on the field with the defense that hadn't gotten enough rest.
You see what Temple has done in the interception department for this season. Russo will throw on the slant. He's got Mack. A gain of 14 and a first down for Temple.
It's just incredibly hard to check a guy that size because you can be in the perfect position, Anish, and if the ball is placed in the right area and you're behind him where you're supposed to be, he will shield you with that frame. And they keep running a lot of slants, and that allows him to utilize that frame of his that is such an asset.
Ray Davis now split wide. Russo looks his way over the middle, incomplete, through the hands of David Martin Robinson, the tight end. Martin Robinson, a big Game of Thrones fan, the books and the TV show. So like the rest of us, waiting for the winds of winter. ETA 2035.
Indeed.
Gardner ambushed in the backfield, and he steps out of bounds after a loss of two. So third and 12 now for Temple.
Wow, Bryce Hutchins blew that play up. I mean, he got off the ball, beat the tackle, and was in the backfield with ease. Now, here is the catch. I'm going to tell you right now, this defense coordinator, Coach Fuller, he loves to bring the pressure. They blitz nearly 40% on each down. This is the type of team that in these types of moments, they pin their ears back, they get after the quarterback, they go man coverage on the back end and force you to make quick decisions. Russo, being a veteran quarterback now, has to recognize that, find the right man, and connect.
Nickel look from Memphis. Russo over the middle, Mack again! Brandon Mack has been unstoppable. Four catches already. He had a career-high 9 last time out against ECU.
Oh, wow. Russo's recognition. Great job of manipulating the pocket. He steps up. He feels the pressure to his face. And an excellently thrown ball. And Mack caught that ball behind him. Typically, you want to catch that ball out in front. But just going to show you just how talented this young man is.
Russo, 5 out of 6. Davis. B buttons his way inside the red zone. And a nice pickup on first down for Ray Davis, freshman from San Francisco. Played prep ball at Blair Academy in New Jersey.
I love the way he finishes runs. Now, whether that's with a sweet move or just power, explosive power. He's a special player.
This is Gardner. It'll bring up third down and short. Some sloppy play early from Memphis, penalties, a turnover, and Temple looking to go up 2 scores halfway through this opening quarter. Gardner again up the middle, and he's going to be short of the marker, so fourth down. And a decision now for Rod Carey, Ahmad.
That is an outstanding play there by Joseph. I mean, wow. Once again, this left side, they beat them twice during this drive. And that's the type of play that shaves points. I mean, and as the big fella's coming off the field right now, I guarantee the coaching staff is pleased with his effort there. And if your Temple, the fact that you got into the red zone and you sputtered, that's something that you want to continue to work on. You've got to get touchdowns, especially taking on a team like Memphis that can put up points extremely fast.
31-yard attempt for Will Mobley. And the kick is good. So Temple with a field goal off the turnover. It all started with Harrison Hand. The interception.
Poor play from Brady White. Excellent play from Hand. And Temple with the kick now up by 10.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Sling TV, the best of live TV, and get thousands of top shows and movies on demand.
This was really neat. Temple created a project called Broken Orchestra. It raised money to repair more than 1,000 broken musical instruments owned by the Philadelphia School District. They got an all-star cast of Philadelphia musicians, including members of the Philly Orchestra, to play these broken instruments.
Wow.
And with the funds raised, all of the broken instruments were either repaired or replaced with a new one and then redistributed to local school children.
That's outstanding. Now, did you play any instruments, Anish?
I played the recorder in third grade and peaked at hot cross buns.
That sounds about right.
Today's player spotlight brought to you by ExxonMobil. Kenneth Gainwell, the running back for Memphis, averaging better than 8 yards per carry. Last year, Mike Norvell faced an excruciating decision to redshirt him. But he had Darrell Henderson and Tony Pollard and Patrick Taylor, who ran for 1,100 yards and has been injured for most of this season. Gainwell was tasked with shadowing Tony Pollard, the all-purpose back, runner, receiver. And you mentioned it earlier, if he had to play wide receiver, he could in a snap.
He's legit, and that's my breakdown on him, and you can see. I mean, he sees the field and hits the rush lanes like a wizard.
Gainwell cuts it back. Got a block from his quarterback. Gainwell using that power. We were watching film. You made the point. He is sneaky powerful.
But this is on cue. How did he find that lane? It was behind him. I mean, it's like he has eyes in the back of his head. This kid is he's a for real talent.
This is a Memphis offense that loves to run the football. They look for ways to run on every play if they can. They'll run it again here. Gainwell shed the initial tackler. Broke about three tackles on that play to pick up close to nine.
I mean, this is an unbelievable play. These are plays that should have been dead in the backfield as he's tapping his head to get a break here, and you deserve one. Once again, the vision. You know, just knowing when to cut, how to cut. These are instincts. Yeah, this kid was born with this. This is not something that Norvell and his staff taught him. He's a guy that football means a lot to him. He has he wants to be great. He works that way. He's one of the hardest workers on this team. He's waited his time behind some great backs here and now taking full advantage of it.
He gets a breather, the freshman from Starkville, Rodriguez Clark, in the game. White to the air on second. Down, the ball is out. Temple had it. Sam Franklin recovers. Franklin down the sideline, tiptoeing the sideline and out of bounds at the 6-yard line. The single digit mafia out in full force in Philly.
Oh my, poor ball protection as Mike Norvell is telling this quarterback right here, but excellent job from this Temple defense. I talked about them being disciplined. He beats the guy to the edge and still maintains his ability to come inside. And that is DeAndre Kelly with the big sack fumble. And now he almost took this to the house. This defense, I'm telling you, the things that stood out. And Brady White is suffering from them now. This is the best defense he's faced all year long, led by Mr. Bradley. But they're disciplined. They're tough when they tackle. And they are masters of effort. You're going to see that show up all day today as... you have this defense. I mean, with no disrespect to the players on this team, they're like a poor man's Florida team. I mean, these guys hit, they're fast, they show up to the stadium upset, angry, and ready to really put somebody's face in the dirt.
Ball moved back to the 12. That's where Franklin stepped out of bounds. Russo moving the pocket. That ball tipped, intended for Jaden Blue.
Great play there.
Wendell Johnson, one of the DBs, got his hand on it.
Great awareness there from the redshirt freshman from New Orleans. And Russo, like I said, they want to get him on the move. Part of the reason for doing that is because of the way that this defense loves to blitz. And they want to change the launch point where if you're going to blitz, you're going to have to chase our guy down. We're not just going to leave him back here like a sitting duck.
Russo looking for Mack, and it's incomplete. Covered by Jacoby Francis, and Temple told us Francis, 32 and white, was somebody they would pick on.
Well, check this out. He's in perfect position, but this is what Mack does. This is an open route for Russo. I appreciate him going there. That ball hit him in the chest. But you see how he's behind that body? If he catches that ball out in front, there is nothing, absolutely nothing Francis can do about it. That would have been a completion.
On third down, here's the blitz. Russo under pressure, intercepted, and then taken away. Wow! Oh, they'll say it's incomplete. Jose Barbone looked like he had wrestled it away.
I think it's a catch. I went back and looked at it on the second time. They need to review this, and it looks like the coach staff
will review it.
What a turn of events here. It looks like he's got an interception. Great effort to not give up on the play. I don't see this ball hit the ground. Oh, there it is. Right there. It's out. Yeah. Great call from the officials. But listen, if you're Temple, you needed that right there.
After your
quarterback has thrown an interception. He's come back. He has a fumble. Being lackadaisical with the football. Now you put yourself in a spot where if you could get that turnover there, now you're getting some momentum back. But right now, Temple has it, and they don't seem like they're ready to relinquish it quite yet.
Now, Ahmad, you look at a couple of plays, both teams missing chances. Mack has a ball, hit him in the chest, incomplete. That's a ball Francis has to intercept as a DB.
Well, and you said it. I think this coaching staff for Temple thought that on the opposite side, T.J. Carter, he's a solid corner, and I like him. On the other side, they felt like Francis did some things that was a great matchup for a guy like Mack. And we've already seen him go to that several times.
Calling on the field is confirmed.
And so I think if you're Francis, what you don't want to do, yeah, I mean, you're talking 5'10 versus 6'5. But if you're Francis, what you don't want to do is get in your own head. I've played the cornerback position, and the worst enemy is yourself. You know, keep playing, and you really do have to have a short memory. Come back out here, continue to play, because this game just started, and there's plenty of football left to play.
Another field goal try from Mobley, who hit from 31. And Mobley, this time from 29, is good. So Temple forcing a couple of turnovers, but only getting 6 points off those two turnovers. This season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to that school's general scholarship fund. Thank you, Allstate. A couple of field goals by Mobley, a touchdown run by Gardner. Temple's up 13-0, but if you're the Owls, yeah, two turnovers, a short field twice. This could have been a 21-0 game. They've had a couple of drives now stall in the red zone. Meanwhile, it's been a rough start for Brady White and Memphis. Tonight, a big one at Kinnick. Number 10 and unbeaten Penn State visits 17th-ranked Iowa, 7:30 Eastern, ABC. Penn State has never beaten a ranked team on the road against James Franklin. Should be a good matchup between that great Penn State defensive front. They had 10 sacks against Purdue last weekend. Iowa, usually so good in the trenches, but they gave up 8 sacks in the loss to Michigan a week ago. White will throw. Incomplete. He wanted Coxey. There is a flag. Christian Braswell on the coverage.
Oh, Braswell was holding. He's almost holding hands with him out there. And wide receiver couldn't even get his hands up to try to make the catch. And you love the aggression. You still got to be smart there. You had great coverage. No need to panic. No need to get a penalty there.
Pass interference. Number 14. Defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
Braswell making his fourth straight start, replacing the injured Linwood Crump in the lineup. Crump is expected back today.
That's great coverage. I just, you know, you don't mind a little shoving and pushing, but you got to be careful with that.
White's pass is knocked down at the line of scrimmage, and right now Temple owning the trenches in this game.
Totally right. And this has just been easy for them as Banks that time comes up with the batted down pass. Just great awareness. And these guys don't give up on plays. You know, he's holding for it there, but once again, he's like, you know what? I can't get to the quarterback. What do I do? Throw up one of those big balls, knock it down, you know, get them behind the chains, and now you're off schedule again if you're Memphis.
Banks, 6'4". Kylan Watkins for a short game. Watkins came into this game averaging better than 6 yards per carry. I think of the rushing production that Memphis lost from a season ago. Darrell Henderson, 1,900-plus yards. Tony
bad
Pollard,
man. That's
1,600 all-purpose yards. And then Patrick Taylor, who only played in one game this year, was an 1,100-yard rusher.
He stacked, and that's why Gainwell was out. Now, Brady White back to a third and medium. They don't like being in this situation. This is all on the quarterback.
Four-man pressure. White going downfield, connecting! Kadarian Jones, the fifth-year senior from Dallas, Texas, with a gain of 43.
When you get punched in the mouth, this is how you respond. His feet were set. This ball was put right on the money. And what I love about his deep ball, man, it's the weight of it. It's so soft. It's just easy to catch.
Ball is out again. And it's covered up by Roche and Temple. Three straight drives for Memphis ending in a turnover. That is not the formula to win on the road in conference.
And they're lucky this didn't go for six. Poor connection and mesh point there from the quarterback to the running back. Not sure what happened, but I know that Temple is dominating.
Memphis head coach Mike Norvell turned 38 yesterday. He's aged another 20 years in the first 12 minutes of this game. Temple with a quarterback change, and this is by design. Todd Senteo, we were told he'd come in on either the third or fourth drive, and he brings the running element to the QB position.
He's got some swag, you know, but they also said the coaching staff was very complimentary of his skill set and said, we don't have to change our game plan when he's in it because he can also do the things we need him to do.
Isaiah Wright in motion. Senteo will keep it again. No gain.
That was a no-go decision. Memphis stepping up, and he might have wanted to hand it off there to Wright to put him in a better situation, but the young man just trying to make a play for his team, and he is a talented player. It's a nice mix-up to what they have in Russo. And as a young man that, as a sophomore, has certainly won the respect of his coaching staff enough to play him in these types of situations. And he's done a fairly good job when he's in there.
He gave Temple a spark in the ECU win last week. Senteo has improved as a passer. And connects to David Martin Robinson for a gain of two. Second catch of the season for the redshirt freshman tight end.
I'd have liked to have seen him to get that ball out of his hand just a little bit earlier. But it's hard when you're moving left or right-handed quarterback. You've got to square up those shoulders to connect on that throw. And this is where, if you're a young sophomore like he is, this is where you grow your game. This is where you prove to the coaches that putting you in these types of situations is good for the team. Make a play here, whether it's with your feet or your arm. Make something happen.
A four-man twist. Senteo will run. Got a good block up front. And squirts ahead for a first down, a gain of 10.
Like some injured Tigers down on the field. Friendly fire.
Trainers will tend to the injured player. It gives us a chance to say hello to Kevin Connors in the studio.
Good afternoon, Anish. Take a look at how things started in the Red River rivalry. A little Donnybrook, a little dust up before the game. Everyone on both teams were given unsportsmanlike conduct penalties, meaning the first one in-game results in an automatic ejection. Jalen Hurts, CeeDee Lamb, his eighth straight game with a touchdown, 7-0 Oklahoma. Back to the Christopher Marlowe of broadcasting, Anish Schroff.
No Shakespeare, though. Meanwhile, the injured player, it appears to be Thomas Pickens. There's a couple of injured Memphis players. One of them is Pickens. Let's see if we can ID the other one. Yeah, you're right. Friendly fire. Carlito Gonzalez, number 29, also down. It's been a rough start for Memphis. Three turnovers, down 13. And now two injured players here at the link. Both Pickens and Gonzalez able to walk off under their own power, so a good sign for Memphis. Tigers still on defense, and they've been milling in retreat most of this first quarter. Temple up 13-0. Todd Senteo in at quarterback as planned. One drive in the first half and then one in the second half. Senteo looked like he had trouble with the ball there after tucking it and still ends up with a nice gain, 7 yards brought down by Austin Hall. A flag is down. And Santeo is down.
Took a shot right under the chin here. Ugh. This is the concern you have, right? He's a guy that's great with his feet. We saw him just get a conversion on a big third down, and now you come back. And this could maybe be targeted. It appeared to be helmet-to-helmet contact there from J.J. Russell. He took a good shot. And this coaching staff, they've got to manage that. You've got to tell a young player, a young sophomore, sometimes those extra yard and a half, it's just not worth it. Get down. You've already made something out of nothing. They need him. Good to see him up.
Russo will come back into the game. Replay does not initiate targeting there. Second down and four. Right, the motion man. Ray Davis into Memphis territory, setting up a third and short.
I'm not saying he's LaDainian Tomlinson, but LaDainian had that same cut. Here's what I'm saying. Behind the line of scrimmage, it's like a shuffle burst, and that is hard to do. It's hard to hit a guy like that, but then he also does it with power. I've been impressed with his cutting ability and the way he makes the initial defender miss.
That's Jagger Gardner moving the chains. And Santeo will come back in for Russo, so a good sign after Santeo went down. Missed a couple of plays.
You know, it's a bad sign when you have to plan for both of these guys.
Well,
and I
Temple
asked the staff,
wanted.
I said, how, you know, the Memphis staff, how hard is it? Because literally, you have to go through all week and trying to plan for both of these guys because you know they'll play. Very difficult to get your players ready for a game like this.
Santeo will set up the screen. This is Isaiah Wright reversing field and spun out of bounds. He'll lose a yard. Temple said part of the reason they use two quarterbacks is so the defense wastes time preparing for Todd Santeo on two drives, and that takes away from how much you can prep for the base offense.
You're absolutely right, and they're so multiple in their formations. They'll come at you with two tight ends. Their personnel groupings are also diverse. Really hard to know what they're doing.
Quarterback draw again. They'll bring up third down as we come to the end of quarter number one. A rough start for Memphis here on the streets of Philadelphia. Three turnovers in the opening 15 minutes. Temple looking for another top 25 win at home. They lead 13-0. Second quarter here at Lincoln Financial Field in Philadelphia. The owl is Temple's mascot because Temple used to be a night school. And Ashraf, Ahmad Brooks, Chris Budden.
You're so smart, man. I feel smarter just being in a room with you.
That is the live mascot, Stella.
My goodness.
Jagger Gardner.
Oh.
Bulldozing ahead for a first down.
Dang right, his offensive lineman took a shot there. Hennessy, center, outstanding. And this guy's a very active center. One of the best in the country. And they move him around a lot, and that time taking a shot from Gardner and keeping on ticking. But they love his smarts. They love his ability to move. He could probably play guard at the next level.
Gardner again trying that right side for a short gain. Coaches told us Hennessy has incredible flexibility. A lot of that is due to early morning yoga.
I love that story. He won't tell the coaching staff when he actually goes, but they believe it's pretty early, like at 6 a.m. or something. But the awareness, this kid wants to be great. And he's willing to put in the time. He's willing to take care of his body. And that shows up on the field.
Rod Carey, a former center at Indiana, says Hennessy's the best center he's been around. Gardner. And now a third down, and we've seen this a few times. Temple, once they get close, their drives stall. The last two Memphis turnovers, Temple was only able to capitalize with field goals.
And I think some of that credit goes to Memphis. Give them
Absolutely.
Credit. Their offense has just been unproductive. But they've come out. They've managed to force two field goals inside of the red zone, and that's awesome. However, it's all for naught if you come back and you give up a play here because you got to keep fighting. We're just barely opening second quarter.
Senteo. This is going to bring up fourth down, and I can see Temple going for it here. You're talking about the very edge of Will Mobley's range.
They're going to give it a shot. They're bringing out special teams. And I think with the way that the game has gone, I don't think you lose anything by not going for it here. You know, if it's fourth and two, fourth and a couple, that makes a little more sense here. You know, give it a whirl. See if you can put one through the uprights and extend this lead.
This would be a new career high for Mobley from 44. And Mobley with his third field goal of this first half, a new career long. Temple has cashed in on all of Memphis's turnovers, but only field goals. Tigers still in this game, even though it's 16-0 Temple.
Welcome back. This Memphis offense in shell shock right now after all the turnovers. Mike Norvell just went over to his offense and said, hey, guys, three turnovers. Play the game, hold the ball. And Brady White, for as big of a leader as he is, has been very quiet. It's been interesting to watch. It's been on the shoulders of the freshman Kenneth Gainwell, trying to laugh, trying to smile, take some of that weight off Brady's shoulders.
And credit this Temple defense. They've created havoc. And so far, they've been successful against one of the better rushing offenses in the country. Three turnovers for Memphis so far today. We check in with Kevin.
All right, Anish, Cars.com matchmaker takes us to Athens, 90th anniversary of Sanford Stadium. South Carolina grabbing the lead. Ryan Helinski to Brian Edwards put the Gamecocks in front. 7-3, but the Dogs come right back. DeAndre Swift, 1 yard touchdown run. 15 straight wins for Georgia against the SEC East. 10-7 Dogs in the second.
That is one Georgia cannot afford to lose. SEC with grand designs right now, thinking maybe three teams in the playoff.
Play game. Offense. 5 yard penalty. First down.
They're just not in sync. And this happens. But here's what you're gonna learn about this undefeated Tigers team and what they're made of. This is tough competition. They're on the road. You're battling with things that you haven't before. How will they respond?
White to the air. Has Jones. There is a flag down. Darian Jones a little slow to get up.
Good shot on the end of that play.
No flag on the play, I guess. It was announced over the PA as well. Gainwell. Not much traction there. It's third down. This is a physical Temple defensive front, and now that front seven, it's a power five front seven.
Make no mistake about it. Just how many jerseys, Temple jerseys were in that frame there. They run to the football, and their effort is just outstanding. Now, look, Brady, this is where you get some momentum. You know, you get a fresh set of downs. This is a play where you're still on schedule. He's got to connect. They've liked quick passing game to the edges in situations like this.
They need the 35. White downfield. Coxey can't make the play. covered by Braswell, and it's fourth down.
Oh, man, that is great coverage. I mean, smothered the wide receiver. Perfect timing for the second time I've seen him today with a second pass breakup. I mean, watch the coverage here. The ball is thrown in the right location, but it's its timing. He goes through those wide receiver hands exactly the way you're supposed to. Textbook from Braswell as he helps this Temple Owls team get off the field.
Now the dangerous Isaiah Wright with a chance on special teams for Temple. Five career return touchdowns. Line drive kick by Williams. Takes a bounce near the 30. And Wright will not have a chance. It's down inside the 25. Temple with a 16-0 lead, keeping one of the top offenses in the American in check.
ESPN, home of the college football playoff.
Yeah, that's surprising because both of these teams have been inefficient with that game, but that's what you expect in a rivalry game. You just don't know what's going to happen. I expect that one to come down to the finish, and I think the best finisher, no disrespect to Jalen Hurts and his national title, is Sam Ehlinger.
Spoken like a Longhorn.
Or an analyst.
Temple keeps it on the ground, and it's Ray Davis tackled by Morris Joseph after a short gain. Ray Davis enrolled early, but his grades were flagged by the NCAA, so he could not compete, couldn't practice, couldn't even lift with the team this spring. And the coaches feel, despite his great production early, he is just scratching the surface of what he can be. Russo over the middle, finds a seam and an open man, Martin Robinson.
You know, Davis, when he came here, was so frustrated he wasn't able to play. He told me yesterday he battles with depression his entire life. So he's been talking with a therapist weekly to try and get his mindset right, worry about the things that he can control. Also does 10 to 15 minutes of meditation each morning.
Young man went to multiple high schools. It's been an odyssey for him. A lot of lateral movement, not much forward progress. Second down.
What about throwing first down? Russo and the coach staff said he's finding his magic. And look, Davis can do his job when Russo is forcing people to defend on the outside edges. When him and his wide receivers are in chemistry and making plays, it's easier for everybody on the field, including the offensive line.
Russo, that one's a low throw. Didn't really give his receiver Blue much of a chance. And it's third down.
Yeah, that's two throws, though, that have been questionable. One where he pump fakes and then just kind of flung it in there, which was an excellent throw. And then that one. Those are decisions that you've got to make sure you're careful with, especially throwing to that side of the field. Carter will gobble that up, and you don't want to exchange turnovers with the Memphis offense right now that has had slippery fingers and has given it to him already three times.
Over the middle again, and that one's broken up and a late flag. Sanchez Blake knocked it down, a penalty marker at the end of the play.
Yeah, that backhand, he just got there early.
Pass interference, number 41, defense. Always place him to spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
And that has nothing to do with Temple converting. Blake's in great coverage here, but it's that back right hand. Now, this is what you're taught. If you shoot with one hand, you want to make sure you still secure the tackle. That's correct. However, the timing of it was wrong. But the coverage wasn't bad up until that point. He just has to finish and complete that play.
From the 43 of Memphis, Russo finding Mack, his fifth catch. And that's the matchup they like, the 6'5 Mac on the 5'10 Francis. When he's been matched up on Francis, Russo is coming for him.
Well, and the thing is, listen, if when Mac totally figures it out, and I think there's still a lot of his game can still be grown, if you will. He's still developing. And he's played a lot of football here and had some good moments, but I think the best is yet to come.
Davis. A powerful run for a first down. Ray Davis came into this game third in the American in rushing, behind Xavier Jones of SMU and Kenny Gainwell of Memphis.
I like how they're calling this game. They are methodically moving down the field. They're controlling the line of scrimmage, the clock. They're getting in and out of plays efficiently. They're executing the plays that are being called, and they're taking advantage of the mistakes from Memphis.
Davis into a barricade, a half yard. The one area, Ahmad, where Temple can be better today. Now, once they get in these scoring areas inside the 30,
right,
in the red zone, they have left points on the board.
You're right, and this is the fifth possession inside of the Memphis 35, so you're totally right, Anish. This is something that, if you're an offense, you've got to take pride in this. Anytime you get close to punching one in, you've got to have closers out on the field that can make things happen.
Out of a two tight end look, Davis to the outside. Torpedoes ahead for a gain of four. Blake with the tackle, and here we go. Another big third down for Temple, just inside the 30.
This offensive line has done a good job against the pressure, because there's no doubt about it. Defensive coordinator for Memphis, he likes to bring the heat. I said it earlier, 40% on just about every down, they blitz. So this is a prime opportunity here with third and medium for them to make it hard on Russo.
Misdirection, the ball's on the ground, and Memphis recovers.
This is what happens sometimes when you try to get some trickery. Wright and Davis just run into each other, and that impacted Russo and his ball placement. We've seen that happen twice today. Mesh point, as Dorsius recovers the fumble, that you've got to do the basics. But now, Memphis has an opportunity to redeem themselves from turning it over already three times.
Anish Shroff, Ahmad Brooks, Chris Budden. A coaching carousel for Temple. Jeff Collins leaves for Georgia Tech. Less than 2 weeks later, Manny Diaz hired to be Temple's head coach. And then a few weeks later, Diaz leaves to go to Miami. Enter Rod Carey coming over from Northern Illinois.
That made my head spin.
Think about all the coaches Temple has had this decade. Joey Magnifico, the tight end! And a big play through the air for Memphis, 35 yards for Magnifico, who has his last name tattooed on his right arm.
Yeah, and that was magnificent. You know, just great job of finding the crease there on a seam route, and Brady doing a nice job of connecting with him.
Gainwell spins away inside the 20. He is fun to watch. 14 yards for the aptly named Kenny Gainwell.
Yeah, I'm glad you said it, because, I mean, this kid, you know, he's the one that you just hold your breath. The excitement, the energy, it heightens when he has the ball in his hands. He's a very dangerous player.
Gainwell again. Barrels inside the 15-yard line. And if Memphis is able to get a touchdown off that last Temple turnover, now this game changes. You can feel the momentum already swinging.
Well, you're punching back, because Temple has gotten points off of their turnover today. Can you do the same thing and get some of your pride back as well, and your confidence in your game plan and in your performance?
Gainwell. No, it's a pass for the end zone. And a touchdown for Memphis. And Coxey, the defense was fooled, and Memphis lands a haymaker off the turnover.
I got to be honest with you, I'm sure glad RPOs weren't in the game when I played. I mean, this is deadly. Now, he can hand the ball off. This is why it's called an RPO. He can run. But in the middle of running, if he decides he wants to pass the ball, he can, and he did exactly that. And he threw it in the perfect location, that back shoulder throw. Brady, that time, it looked better. His feet were set on the throw that he connected over the middle of the tight end, and then finishing it off there with an excellent throw and finish as Memphis finally gets in the end zone.
Riley Patterson for the PAT. Booms it through.
Since we're in Philly, we'll use the boxing analogy. Temple getting three Memphis turnovers, only landing jabs. Memphis gets one Temple turnover and pops a haymaker.
I see.
Western Michigan's added another one, 14-6. Anish?
All right, action. We love it, Connors.
Nice.
Devontae Coxey has gotten Memphis on the board, a one-time LSU commit. One of just three Memphis receivers with a 1,000-yard season. The other two, Isaac Bruce and Anthony Miller.
Woo! Great company showing. Two outstanding college players. Sure.
Temple will take it out at the 25-yard line. Coming tomorrow, Sunday NFL Countdown, before they square off, it's quarterback to quarterback. Russell Wilson and Baker Mayfield, plus Peyton Manning goes one-on-one with Brett Favre. That's at 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. And then Monday Night Football comes to Lambeau. Detroit and Green Bay, the Packers, 4-1. Their only loss coming to a Philly team, losing to the Eagles. Our statistician cheering in the press box. He's a Packers fan, violating a cardinal rule.
Oh, my man. Oh, Paul.
Anthony Russo will throw on first down. Dangerous throw. He was late to the sideline, and T.J. Carter nearly had his eighth career pick.
Did you see the difference there? Oh, man, this is, whoo. This is why you'd want to go away from this kid. I mean, his body control, his ability to get in and out of the route. He gets something on the wide receiver. Now, that is a task. We're talking about a guy who's 5'11", taking on somebody who's 6'5", but he fought, he battled, got converted back underneath the route and almost had an interception. Russo has to be careful going to that side of the field that he occupies.
Yeboah motion, second down. Gardner rips off a nice run. And he'll move the sticks for Temple.
That was great blocking out in front. He got in behind it and did a nice job of being patient, and they just continued to get pushed and pushed and pushed, and he cut at the right time. And this offense has been, they've been good. They just have sputtered when they've gotten into the 35, but every drive they've had today has gotten inside of Memphis 35. They've moved the ball. That has not been a problem.
Russo again to the air, looking for Mack, goes up high to catch it. Carter, the former American Conference Defensive Rookie of the Year, rather Claybrooks. That's Chris Claybrooks, excuse me, with the tackle. Claybrooks making his first appearance of the season. And Ahmad, to your point, Temple, that early touchdown, and then field goal, field goal, field goal, fumble. Memphis is too good of a team if you just let them hang around. Mack lined up at the bottom of your screen. He's got six catches already. Russo rolling to his left. Throws downfield. And it's ruled a catch. Jaden Blue enjoying a breakout sophomore season. He's the team's leading wide receiver coming into the game.
I like him. You know, I think... he's got a shot out there on the edge. This is a good ball by Russo. Great job. That's an outstanding play. What a safe throw on that corner route. You want it low and away, and the wide receiver showing great body control, great hands, hand-eye coordination there to haul that ball in for a first down.
Here we go. Temple back in Memphis territory again. Gardner. He's a bigger back, too. 230 pounds, 6'2". Battled some injuries in his career. Began the year as the starter, and then the emergence of Ray Davis has relegated Gardner really to number two duty.
And he's not going to try to run by you. He's going to run through you.
Yeah. He's a power back, but he also has the longest run in school history, 94 yards as a freshman against SMU.
Probably about 30 pounds lighter. Training table will do that to you.
Here's Ray Davis. Pinballing off defenders and a first down run, a gain of 10.
The initial contact on this kid, and his yards after contact is through the roof. It's so fun watching a player like this. Both he and Gainwell have a knack for this. They're slippery, but they're strong. And they're small in stature, but they really do use their leg drive to break through tackles. And they use it exactly the way the smaller backs that have dominated football, they do it. With power, with grace, right? And then on the back of that, you make a play.
Russo, clean pocket, downfield for Blue. Incomplete. He and Carter were tangled. No flag. It's second down and Ahmad. Temple has now been inside the Tiger 35 on every drive. And it's still just a 16-7 game.
Now you just got to get out of the way. And I thought there might have been some contact there on the outside edge there from Carter. They let him play through it. However, you know, now, but look, it's hard to score once you get inside the 30 because of you can't really go downfield, and it allows those safeties to really come down and hammer the run. However, Temple's got to find an answer.
Russo looking for Mack again. And Brandon Mack makes the catch for a first down.
Ooh, this was a big-time throw. I mean, Russo, he let this thing fly. And he let it fly early. He anticipated the cut. He knew what he wanted. He stood tall in the pocket. And once again, low and away, utilizing the frame of Mack at 6'5", he was able to catch that football. And now you're starting to keep on moving, keep on chugging. Maybe review this. Waiting on the chains. You know, you think about it, with these up-tempo offenses, I mean, you know, the real heroes are the people that run the chain game. Do you know how fast you have to set up and then you have to sit? My heroes, as the officials here, I mean, that's got to be tough. It's tough to call plays, but I bet it's really tough to run up and down that sideline trying to mark the football.
You get your steps in every day doing that. Russo is hit. Incomplete, too high for right. And a flag down. Carter was on the coverage.
Holding, number two, defense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
One tendency smaller defensive backs have is to tug. And you know, you've got to know where to do it. I always, when I'm teaching it, you want to go low, and you never want to let a jersey separate. And he was going to work on this skill. Some of the great defensive backs that are smaller do this. And so, but he's been uber-aggressive today, over-aggressive, and it's cost him a few times with penalties.
Here's Wright to the outside. Isaiah Wright hurdles into the end zone for a touchdown.
Oh, my goodness. Woo. Now, he's the best athlete on the field. And when I say athlete, I mean in terms of what he looks like, what he's capable of doing, his size and strength, but it's on full display right here, the way he beat them to an angle. And then the end of that play, you really only have one shot to try to tackle this kid who's big. He's 6'2", 220, but he can still jump. I mean, he hurdled him like he was, you know, running at pin relays. Wow. What a play.
Isaiah Wright, the senior from West Hartford, from Weehaw to Wawa. Kevin Connors, the mayor of Weehaw.
Hey, it is coming up on the Army National Guard halftime report. We'll check in on the Red River rivalry. A bit of a surprise defensive showdown there. We'll preview Florida LSU under the lights in Death Valley tonight. And wait till you see what's going on in Athens, Georgia right now. All coming up when you join me, Coach, and Acho on the Army National Guard halftime report. Anish?
Casey, I appreciate it. We look forward to that. This has the makings of one of these weeks where you kind of get a sense we may see a little crazy.
It's November.
And it's October.
Pardon me. We're broke.
It's not even Halloween.
I want it to be November. No, I mean, this time of the year is when October and November is really when you start to have an identity of your team. You're in the conference play, and that's when you really start to see what you're made of. And you're speaking of that, I mean, one of the top, I've got Memphis as the second best team in the American, right behind SMU. And I think it could be disputed about Cincinnati and also Temple in that mix, Tulane also. as a team. But the reality of it is Memphis right now has their back against the wall. And if they are the best team, they're going to have to respond very quickly.
Three teams in the American in the top 25. UCF, the juggernaut in this league, not one of them. This season, Taco Bell celebrating student sections and passionate fans like these, the Cherry Crusade, by awarding the Liv Moss Student Section of the Year. The Temple Owl Student Section is already on the national watch list. Go to ESPN.com/Taco Bell to see how your school can compete or get the committee's attention by using hashtag Liv Moss Student Section Contest. .221 to go in this first half. Temple with a 16-point lead on undefeated Memphis. Owls already beat a ranked Maryland team here at the link. Gainwell tried a little juke move. He's to the 32, second and three coming up.
When they go to that empty look, it's a lot of quick passes. And I also think that's a great opportunity for Brady White, who's not necessarily a runner, to take advantage of the defense if they are in coverage.
There's the blitz off the edge, downfield. It's tipped incomplete. Coxie unable to hang on.
And he scored on that play. He scored on that back shoulder earlier in the ball game, and the timing of it has been great, and Brady throws an excellent ball on that back shoulder. All it is to defend. I mean, it's to dupe the defense. You're running with the wide receiver. All of a sudden, he turns back, and you're trying to stay high to prevent the deep throw. And he doesn't connect. But here, once again, a third down. They've got two people in the backfield. This is a set that they like to run the ball out of or get into their read option or RPO package.
White has Coxie for a first down at the 41-yard line. And with less than 2 minutes, that will stop the clock until the ball is spotted. Memphis has all three timeouts. Four-man rush. White, shovel pass, Gainwell. Across midfield. And out of bounds at the 40-yard line, a gain of 18. Clock stops with 1:34 to go.
That's a great improvisation there from White. You know, and if there's a guy you want to flick it to, it's his Gainwell, who just showed, I mean, he's just eating up grass and yardage so quickly, so powerfully. And great play there from Brady White and two of the bright stars out here today on the field.
White rolling to his right. All day to throw, sideline. And the catch is made by Coxie at the 25. Clock stops with 1:25 to go. It'll start on the official signal. And there's an injured player. And it's a Temple player. And that is Dana Levine, fifth-year senior, originally from Philly, but his family moved to Florida when he was in middle school. Tell you what, Brady White, after a rough start and a rough first quarter, has been better. And go back a few games against Navy. White was booed at home, wasn't playing well. Coming off the field, he gave Mike Norvell a little smile. And Norvell said afterwards, that showed me right there, he's got this. And he responded. And the one thing we've seen from Brady White, he's gotten better at handling adversity.
You've got to have tough skin if you're a quarterback, and you've got to handle the hate and the hype the exact same way, in one ear, out the other, because you don't want to get a big head for making great plays. And this team is off to a great start, and Brady White has been a major part of that. On the flip side of that, he's had some poor performances. He's had some things where he would tell you wasn't up to par his standard of play. And I know from the quarterback position, that is one of those places where you've really got to try to do a good job of blocking those things out, because if not, Anish, you get in your own head, you start listening to what's happening out on the outside and the noise, and it can be detrimental to your game.
He's made some plays downfield as well, and Temple told us, if Memphis is going to beat us, it's going to be Brady White throwing the ball downfield. White's pass, that was a dangerous one, incomplete. Sam Franklin nearly had his second turnover of the day. Coxey, the target.
I'm not sure what he saw there, because Franklin was in perfect hook-to-curl coverage, meaning he's got to get back to that hash, his eyes are on the quarterback, and he can flow freely depending on where the quarterback throws the ball, and he did exactly that. That play was covered. I might have done something different there.
Gainwell on second down, has running room, inside the 10, still going, touchdown, Kenny Gainwell!
Oh my goodness, welcome to college football on a big stage. This kid is for real. Gainwell, watch the power on this throw. It starts with the patience, and when he gets in behind those blockers, you can't see him. You can't spot him from the second level. And then he's so fast when he comes out. But did you see the determination on the back end of that run? He nearly drugged defenders into the end zone with him and then took a shot and still didn't fall. Gainwell, boy, he's got it.
He's got close to 120 yards of total offense already. 48 receiving, 71 on the ground. His job a season ago when he played in four games and redshirted was to shadow Tony Pollard. Pollard was your do-everything back. Yeah. He could run it. He could catch it. He was a beast on kick returns. Gainwell was going to be used in that role this season, but then Patrick Taylor got hurt after the first game, and they had to move him to running back. And Mike Norvell said, listen, Gainwell is so good. If Taylor were to come back next week or the week after and Gainwell would have to move to the slot or play receiver. He knows the wide receiver playbook so well, he might be their best wideout.
He also said along those lines, piggybacking off of that, he said, one of the hardest decisions I had to make was redshirting this kid. It's like having a new toy, but, you know, it's like Christmas. All these presents under the tree, you know they're there for you, but you can't open them yet. But Gainwell, since being given the opportunity, has done nothing but impress his staff. He's won players over in the locker room. And he's a hard worker. Now, can he stay humble? Can he stay hungry? That'll be the challenge with him, because competing at this level certainly is not.
Now, last year you had Darrell Henderson and Pollard in front of you, both NFL backs, and Patrick Taylor, who ran for more than 1,000 yards. Well, we hope Tom Jackson gets well soon. He's still recovering from that Achilles injury. So Ryan Clark back with Boomer on NFL Primetime Sunday, 7:30 ESPN Plus. Highlights, breakdowns from the day's games, updates after the Sunday night and Monday night games, and cameos from SVP and Joe Tess.
Coming off a scoring drive now, and now you're into your two-minute offense. They'd like to score some points here. It'll go fast and probably take a shot at some point downfield.
Ray Davis on the 50th play run by Temple in his first half. And a timeout by Memphis. It took the Tigers a little while to wake up. The first quarter was a total disaster, but Temple could not capitalize. Three Memphis turnovers led to just 9 points. And yeah, that's the difference in the game right now.
Yeah.
But I think not getting more points off of those turnovers could come back to haunt Temple in the second half, because Memphis has picked up some momentum here in the second.
I think you're right. I mean, they squandered those types of opportunities. It's just hard. And here go the turnovers. Here's the first one. Brady, just an ill-advised throw. I'm not sure what he was doing there. And it appeared to be maybe some miscommunication. And then just loose with the football. You've got, anytime you step up, you got a security. Didn't do that. Led to another turnover.
A first down run by Ray Davis and a flag. It looks like we got a face mask on the end of the play. Now this is coming back.
Holding for 58 offense. 10-yard penalty. Give me second down.
That's the all-conference center.
At the clock, start on the snap.
So Memphis had the option there of the 10-second runoff, because that would have stopped the clock. But again, they want to get the ball back here, so they decline the 10-second runoff. see if Temple bleeds some clock. They don't. And the tackle is made by Pickens on the carry by Davis. It'll be third down. Memphis calls another timeout. Were you surprised there? Temple didn't let the clock run a little more?
Well, number one, they came out with three consecutive running plays. And like that to me just almost seems like you're conceding. Now, granted, on the first two, the safeties were high, so I understand that. You've got a great back, so you give it to Davis, thinking maybe he can make some plays on the second and third level. But I'm not sure what that run is about right there.
But if you're conceding, why not let the clock run?
But this is my point. It's very confusing. That's one of those things where if you're Rod Carey, you go back and you look, you're going to say, I could have done something a little bit better. And you could tell this is the hardest thing for a head coach to do. I'm being able to make these types of decisions, I don't envy them, but they've got to be done right. If not, it is your responsibility to manage the clock, manage your team, especially during the closing minutes of the half and the game.
A lot of the fans here are Eagles fans, and they watched Andy Reid for a lot of years, right?
You had to start the pot.
They've seen that movie a few times in the stadium. That's all I'm trying to say. So now third and 12. Memphis has a timeout left. Temple will keep it on the ground. And now Memphis will use its final timeout. It's fourth down. 48 seconds to go. And Temple has had some issues in the punting game. They have not had to punt today. Adam Barry has been inconsistent. We were told before the game that Jacob LaFree, who's been handling kickoffs, would handle the first punt. He's a graduate transfer from the University of Indianapolis. Largely been handling kickoffs this year. So this play right here is not a sure thing, and it might give Memphis a chance at a long field goal. They've got a kicker who can hit from well beyond 50.
There's no might. It does give them a chance. I mean, you can manage inside of the time that they're going to have, and as you said it, now Brady's starting to get his feet under him. He can throw the ball downfield. He's capable of that, but you also have dynamic playmakers that you can check down to, like Gainwell, which I fully anticipate them to also have that option of doing in their arsenal.
So LaFree will indeed punt, and Travion Samuel is the deep man. Short kick. Bounces at the 40. Samuel lets it bounce. It takes the Temple bounce out of bounds at the 30. Ends up being a 46-yard boot.
This is great field position. this is great field position, and a score is well within your striking distance. Now, it's a matter of the right play calls. Mike Norvell calls the plays for his team. If I'm him, I put the ball in the hands of my playmakers, or I go down trying to get it into the hands of my playmakers. Gainwell has worked for them today. He's worked for them all season long. And if you're Temple, know where 19 is at. Don't let him be the guy that beats you. You're going to be in one-on-one opportunities probably everywhere else where you don't double him. And those guys got to do their job and execute the defense.
And if they can get to about the Temple 40, you give Patterson a chance.
Yep.
White rolling out. Heaves it down the sideline for Coxey, and it's broken up. Christian Braswell's had himself a pretty good first half.
Oh, man. Hey, this kid's growing on. I'm serious. I like the way he's played, and you have to have the right competitive edge and nature out at the cornerback position. He's been locked up in one-on-one coverage. That's what they like to do. And he's won his matchup today. He's having a fine game, and he's really helped his team and his defensive coordinator get in and out of plays because of his reliability on the edge.
Yeah, Benny Walls, the starting safety, banged up today. We have not seen him in the first half. White checks down. He's got Gainwell across the 40, and that's a first down run. That will momentarily stop the clock. 25 seconds to go. Clock will start on the official signal. White to the air, dangerous throw. Jones can't hang on.
Big time play there out of Amir Tyler separating the wide receiver from the ball. And he had it within his grasp, did Jones, but the big hit here just jars the ball loose. Brady trying an opportunity. That play would have connected.
So what do you do now?
Give Temple credit. And I think, what do you do? Well, here's the thing. Mike Norvell, who's trying to communicate here somewhere with his offense, Listen, they said it earlier. Sometimes you can double Gainwell, but when we hand it off to him, you can't. I'd give him the ball somehow, some way.
White under pressure, and down he goes. Sacked by Ifeanyi Maijay. His sixth of the season. He has been a force on that defensive line for Temple. And Memphis unable to tack on going into halftime.
I'm glad you said it. This guy, Maijay, he's relentless. He works. He's great. I saw him make a goal line play where he goes two gaps over and makes a tackle. Special young man. Special half here for the Owls.
Temple closes the first half with some defensive punctuation. They'll get it first to begin the third quarter. After the break, it's the halftime report.
Kevin Connors in studio. We want to apologize for the technical issues we've been having in Philadelphia, but the good news is we are back up and running. So let's take you back down to the city of brotherly love. Memphis and Temple, Lenny Schroff, Ahmad Brooks on the call, guys.
Thank you, Kevin. We do have some of our cameras operational. Memphis will start from its own 5-yard line, working left to right from the far hash. First possession of the second half, and Joseph Dorsius, the big D lineman, comes in to play fullback.
This is a run.
And it is. It's Gainwell. Dorsius clearing out some trees. And Gainwell picks up a couple, ran into a sea of cherry.
Mike Norvell told me at half he was actually pretty pleased with the way his offense had responded after those turnovers. He says it's just so hard to get into a rhythm when you turn the ball over that many times. He said, I'm confident that if my group continues to play smart, then we can win this thing. Rod Carey on the other side said, we got to get back to pressuring Brady up front. That's how we were disrupting them in that first quarter.
White moving the pocket, finds Coxie, and brought down by the ankles. Aaron Monroe with the stop, 15 yards, the first down. Temple with 9 points, 3 field goals off of 3 Memphis turnovers, and that is the difference. Handoff. Not much running room, only a yard. We thank you for bearing with us through those technical difficulties. Our cameras are back and working, as you can see. Play action. White over the middle. He's got Gainwell. Sheds one tackle. And Kenny Gainwell to the 45-yard line. A gain of 22. Up to 88 yards receiving. He's got 74 on the ground. Another all-around A-plus performance by the redshirt freshman from Yazoo City, Mississippi.
I'm going to tell you what, that was an excellent play call. I mean, the play fake went to him, and he just burst through the line. Normally, that guy's not accounted for. Mike Norvell called the right play and drew up the right play at the same time.
White rolling out, finds Jones out of bounds close to the sticks. So second and one, and now Mike Norvell can really open up the playbook. White again moving the pocket. Now he'll try to run for the first down. I guess they had the first down already. Initially they marked him shy, then they changed it. So they already had the first down, and it'll be second and 9 after a gain of a yard.
Great perimeter coverage there from Sam Franklin and guess who? Christian Braswell. They were nowhere to throw the ball. And when you bootleg like that or you sprint, it forces only half a field read, so you can't throw backfield, so it limits who you can throw the football to.
White under pressure, and he's sacked. It's Zach Mesday, the former walk-on, who has battled through 2 torn ACLs, a 6th-year senior.
An amazing story, and for what this kid has been through, I mean, you could just tell heart, determination. He was not going to let anybody block him on that play. And he just fights through. And now he puts them in the prime position here for them to win on third down at this point on the field. And that could be the difference in them getting the ball back without giving up points.
Temple brings four. Screen pass. Gainwell in the clear. He does it again. When in doubt, give it to number 19.
Man, I love the way they've used him. I mean, it's just been so many different ways. This time, just once again, you bring him out of the backfield. It works previously, right? And you're not accounting for that guy. And Mike Norvell is so creative in the ways that he and his staff find him to get the football. That's what makes him so dangerous, is they still get it to him, even though you know it's getting to him.
Gainwell, little hesitation, picks up a couple. He is within striking distance of a 100-yard rushing and 100-yard receiving game. In fact, that last catch puts him right at 100 yards through the air on seven catches.
That's laughable, with 8 minutes to go in the third quarter. So, just shows you what type of productive player Gainwell can be.
Rodriguez Clark in at running back. Clark plows across the 25, brought down by Myjay. And another third down now for this Memphis offense.
They've had success on this down. And if you're Brady, you want the ball in your hands here. And when they go to this spread look, well, this time they have them tight and attached, which still allows them to run the football inside. And the box seems to be stacked. So I'd go to the outside edges with this football.
Kylan Watkins up the middle. Watkins, touchdown!
Whoa. Watch this. I mean, they've got numbers. If you're Temple, how do all those jerseys miss the ball here? I mean, they had favorable numbers, Temple did, and he goes untouched. And it wasn't until here that's. Now, that knee might have been down. That might have been something that they'll review. But if you're Temple, you are disappointed in your effort. You put the right numbers in if you're the defensive coordinator, Jeff Knowles, and your team just doesn't execute and get the job done. On the flip side, if you're Memphis, that is what you needed, and you are back in this ball game. And I believe now you have command.
No review. The PAT is good. Kylan Watkins began his career at UT Martin. Didn't really get much of a chance there. Transferred to Memphis, and he finds the end zone. Tigers within two. It was the nightmare of real things early for Memphis on the road, playing as a top 25 team. Three first quarter turnovers. But it did get better.
Well, and I thought it started with their quarterback, Brady White. He calmed down. He never got rattled by this. And then they started to run the football. And you can't get enough of touches to Gainwell. But then you come back and you've got Kylan Watkins you can also hand it off to. And the Temple defense, they should be disappointed in their efforts on that last play. The coaching staff put them in the right play. And Memphis beat them because they wanted it more. And there was no one around there. And that's something that you look back over. Temple's done a good job against the run. They're known for that, being physical. But Memphis has really gained control over that now, and they're rolling.
A line drive kick. It'll skip into the hands of Isaiah Wright. Five career return touchdowns. And he is gobbled up in his sea of white at the 27. Tonight, Penn State visiting Iowa. Battle of two ranked teams. Over at Kinnick, Nittany Lions have won five straight against the Hawkeyes. Penn State has won all of its games this year by an average of almost 40 points, but a James Franklin team has never beaten a ranked team on the road. That's his head coach at Penn State.
And they quietly climbed up the rankings there, you know, silently after Michigan lost.
Russo off play action. Incomplete. We check in with Kevin.
And Anish, again, the defensive battle, the story of the Red River rivalry. 10-3 game, early third quarter, and then Rashawn Johnson says, enough of this defense, right? 57-yard run down inside the OU 10-yard line, and he's able to finish off the drive. 4-yard touchdown run to tie things up in the Red River rivalry. Texas OU not at a 10, Anish.
All right, thank you, Kevin. There it's third down for Temple after a run by Gardner. Last year it was Dicker the kicker, the hero for Texas in the Red River rivalry.
Well, it looks like that one will come down to a fourth quarter game, and one we have right here appears to be that way as well. And Temple's struggling right now offensively.
Facing a third and 10. Russo's pass incomplete. It was tipped. And three and out go the Owls.
But it was like he was kind of debating. Do I throw it? Not throw it. And he tried to keep it in his hand, but it came out. I mean, he almost threw it right directly in the dirt. And like I said, they're struggling. And you've got experience on that side at the quarterback position. You've got some real leaders in Hennessy, their center. Right now is the time where they've got to step up, calm the team down. You're in a good position. Make things happen and get your consistency going back.
Now the punting game. Memphis second nationally in special teams efficiency. Temple second worst. Pretty good field position for Memphis just inside its own 40. This one might go the distance in Philly. When Rod Carey came to Temple, he already saw a program built on the scaffold of toughness, physicality, and defense. The single-digit numbers go to the toughest Temple players, and Carey asked his leaders, hey, what do you want to keep from the previous regimes? And they said, we want to keep the Temple tough mantra. We want to keep the single-digit numbers, and maybe most importantly, we want to keep Friday dinners at Fogo de Chao.
I don't blame them.
Joey Magnifico, the tight end, makes the catch for a gain of 5. According to family legend, the last name was originally Mangiafico, but it may have been changed at Ellis Island. Magnifico and his brothers have embraced it. Magnifico has the name tattooed on his right arm. His brother has it on his back. How about Brady White fooling the defense for a gain of 4 to set up 3rd and 1?
He was decisive there. We saw him earlier in the game where they fumbled in that mesh point.
There is that tattoo.
Nice.
Magnifico. First team tight end on the all-name team in college football. Gainwell using the stiff arm. Gets back to the line of scrimmage. All right, fourth down. Down 2 on the road. Minus territory technically. Does Mike Norvell
roll the dice? But that was Sean Bradley that got in the backfield, and Gainwell knocked him down. So, I mean, that's one of the best defenders in the American and one in the country. And now is where you need your senior leadership to step up. They're bringing in big boy package. And that means that if you're Temple, you've got to hold fort here. You come downhill flying, make something happen.
Dorsey is the D lineman in at fullback. Gainwell stood up. Myjay in hand, and this felt eerily reminiscent of the goal line stand against Maryland.
Oh, my goodness. And you're right. And the one of the catalysts there was Myjay. He's in the middle of the field. Now, he takes on a block. Watch him, number 88. He tracks all the way downfield. That's not his gap. That's not where he's supposed to be. He does his job on the double team and then comes back and makes a play. Anish, when we were watching film this week, this dude is active. I mean, he's built right for the position at 6'2", 285. He's got the specs. He's a baby. He's a redshirt sophomore. But he's made plays like this before. That was a big stop for Temple. And if you're Memphis, you're going to the sideline saying, we've got to make that play. We've got to get a yard when we need it.
Todd Senteo in at quarterback. They'll keep it on the zone read. To the 42.
I like the personnel change here because Russo and the previous drives didn't look sharp. And now you can run the football, get some of this clock to get out of here, and now you can clear your head, and you can still get into your package. But I like the personnel change. I think that was the right time.
Davis to the outside and tripped for a loss of a yard. It's third down. We were told Senteo would come in for two series today. We saw him in the first half, and we were told he'd get one in the second half. So this appears to be Senteo's drive, the running quarterback, much improved as a passer. And Rod Carey told us he's too good to keep off the field. Third down for Temple, 4 of 11 today. Back to Davis. It'll bring up fourth down, and if you're Rod Carey now,
roll the
what
dice.
You
go for it. You know, on the other sideline, you've got a coach that's courageous enough as there's an injured man down on the field.
That's Jovan Fair, the left guard. Temple's got a pretty good offensive line, but not a ton of depth. And Fair was an all-conference lineman a season ago. Fair is down, fourth and two for the Owls when we come back. They're looking at Jovan Fair on the sideline, the starting left guard for Temple. Leon Pinto would come in if Fair can't go. It's fourth and two, Temple. The offense takes the field. Senteo remains in at quarterback. Pinto is in there at left guard. Blue in motion. Blue gets it. Blue has some room. Blue inside the 20. Taken down at the 11-yard line. What a call by Temple.
They told us yesterday this call was designed for this game. The zigzag motion bringing them back across the field. They got the numbers they wanted. And it requires great handwork there from the quarterbacks, kind of flick it out. And then Blue, he's so fast. He's going to beat you to the edge, but he turned up right, nearly scored a touchdown. What a
Brandon
gutsy call.
Mack, who's got seven catches in the slot. Two tight ends in the game. Mack in motion. Mack, a high school quarterback. He'll throw it to Senteo. Juggles it, holds on, and takes it inside the 10, and then coughs it up at the end.
It looked like his knee was down, but geez.
Whew. TJ Carter came away with it.
Oh, my goodness. Those knees. Watch the knees here. That's what you're looking for. Certainly has possession of the football. But were those knees down before the brilliant play by Carter? That's a close one. Oh, my goodness.
The ruling on the field was a forced fumble.
That's a fumble.
And
fumble.
That ball is out before Senteo goes down.
Whoa.
Wow.
Oh, wow. Carter. Jeez. Listen, they haven't thrown much his way, and there's been a reason. I talked about his aggression on the outside edge. That is awareness. That has nothing to do. That's smarts. That's understanding where you are. That's knowing you've got a guy that's not used to carrying a ball like that. And wham, just rips it out. Outstanding play there from the junior.
Ahmad, you talk about a game of inches. If Senteo catches that clean, that's probably a touchdown.
Walks
in.
A touchdown. You're right, Anish.
Instead, it's a turnover. And Memphis now with the ball from its own 7-yard line. Antonio Gibson breaks one tackle up the sideline, taken down at the 20, and that will be a horse collar tackle against Sam Franklin. Tack on 15 more yards.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle, number 4. Defense, 15-yard penalty for the end of the run. First down.
Remember, the last Memphis drive started at the 5 and they scored. This one started at the 7, and the catch and the penalty makes that a 28-yard play.
I like Franklin a lot. He's a senior. That's not a play he should be making. But he's also capable of making a poor play like that and coming back and making a game-changing play. That was a great job there also by Gibson on the outside edge to win that matchup versus Hand. They've gone after him, and their wide receivers have won the battles majority of the day.
So it ends up as a 23-yard gain with the catch and the penalty. Now, we wondered early in this game, Ahmad, Temple only getting three field goals off those three early Memphis turnovers. Starting with the second quarter, Memphis has been moving the ball almost at will. Gainwell to the 35, a pickup of five. Kevin?
And you know what, Anish, this is more like it in Dallas. OU Texas 10-10 game. Check out the creativity. Lincoln Riley dialing up the flea flicker. Jalen Hurts to CeeDee Lamb. Covers 51 yards. His second touchdown catch of the day. Hurts has a pick. OU's driving again. 17-10, third quarter.
Gainwell limped off the field here. Watkins in at running back. Magnifico makes the catch. Picks up a couple. It's third down and three.
Yeah, to throw that with Quincy Roach all in his face. I mean, all over him. That was actually a smart play.
There's Gainwell limped off the field after his last attempt. So now your best offensive weapon is on the sideline on third and three. Speed option. White tosses it to Watkins late. And he is tackled right at the 40. This is going to be awfully close.
Pretty white to get shot. Oh, my. His defense.
It's enough for a first down. No measurement needed.
That's close. Great job here by Memphis. Just trying to figure out a way. Now, this is not a play they've run all day today. Brady nearly trips up, manages to get the ball out there.
Oh, man. Might have been deflected, too.
Oh, boy.
They continue to work on Gainwell on the sideline. Incomplete forward pass for Gibson. Looks like cramps on the sideline.
Guys, they're rubbing down his left calf and trying to feed him up with some fluids right now.
For the day he's had, it's not surprising that this young man, I mean, he's been all over the field. He has been a difference maker. He's been a game changer, a playmaker. And they asked him to wear a lot of hats, and today he's worn them well.
Watkins wrangled to the ground. No gain. It's third and long. Chappelle Russell, part of that straight flush middle linebacking core. Russell three, Franklin is four, Bradley is five.
Temple has some very athletic and active linebackers. Here, I would drop back in coverage, keep everything in front of me. Keep in mind where the marker's at. If I'm the safety, I sit right there, and I force Brady to beat me with his arm.
Memphis 5 of 8 on third down. Make it 6 of 9 as Coxie holds it in.
They did exactly what I said. Four-man rush, they drop numbers back, and the guy that has been most reliable today turns the wrong way in coverage. You always turn into the wide receiver. That was the difference. And when you're 5'10", that inch is the difference in you jumping and knocking that ball down, and you not, but give Memphis credit. They made the play when they needed to.
Gainwell back into the game for Memphis. Screen pass. It's too high for Gibson. Incomplete. And that is the final play of this third quarter. Temple jumped out to a 16-0 lead today. Memphis has roared back. It's a two-point game. We go to the final 15 minutes of regulation in Philadelphia. Slinging It. It's brought to you by Sling TV. Brady White, the grad transfer from Arizona State, north of 300 yards today. Anthony Russo, 14 of 24, 160 through the air. What teams have done to capitalize on the opponent's mistakes today has told this game narrative. Memphis with a touchdown off of one Temple turnover. Now they're driving off of a second Temple turnover. Temple off three Memphis turnovers managed three field goals. It's second down and 10. A five receiver look, low snap. Brady White will run and nose dives forward. The ball is out. Another turnover by Memphis. Picked up by Tyler. And every turnover for the Tigers has been on the quarterback.
Let's see if he was down here. That ball was out. That ball got jarred out by Harrison Hand. You talk about a young man who's had some challenges today. They have picked on him. They've gone his way. He ends up coming up with a big hit on the quarterback. That looks like a fumble. I doubt that'll be overturned. I don't see enough there. And Temple, wow. And if you're Brady White, right, this is the second time today you've let one go when it's within your grasp. I know he's not necessarily a runner, but you've got to protect the football there and know that the hit is coming.
He threw a pick. He's fumbled twice, and a third fumble was on the wrong mesh point on an attempted handoff as Gardner catches the swing pass and takes it to midfield.
Well, twice now, Anthony Russo has gone up to his offense on the sidelines and said, I don't understand why we're look scared and why we're playing scared. Wipe that off your face. I believe in you. And then had a long conversation privately with Isaiah White.
No shortage of leadership on this Temple team. Russo finds Mack. Over 100 yards receiving for the second straight game. And a first down at the 36. When you have the amount of coaching turnover Temple has had, a lot of guys on this team, like Russo, were recruited by Matt Rhule, played for Rhule, then played for Collins, and then Manny Diaz comes in for less than 3 weeks. Now it's Rod Carey to sustain success. Locker room leadership is everything, and Rod Carey told us as much.
Said this is a close-knit group, and how could they not be?
And he said it was on the coaches to gain their trust.
I think he's right there.
Hand off. Gardner busting inside the 15. Finally brought down by Quindell Johnson.
Wow, this is just great blocking up front, and they get one from Adam Klein. Watch the right side or left side of your screen. Watch them just clear the way. And it's that crease because they held on to their blocks. And 58, Matt Hennessy pancaking his guy on the inside. The offensive line has taken over, and that play is proof of it.
Pinto still in at left guard for Fair. Gardner right into the embrace of the Tigers. Tim Hart stood him up initially.
And I know we've talked today about them struggling inside of 35 or when they get near the end zone. This is a hard place to score because of how it minimizes your space, right? So you're not really able to throw long, and now you have to use the width of the field.
Looking for Mack. He brings it in! And Temple seizes the momentum off of the Memphis turnover.
I tell you what, Russo recognizes this matchup. He saw it. He wanted it from the jump. Joey Bryant is on his best target tonight, his most favorable target. And I think people that have been around this program knew that Matt could be a special player. And he was just putting it all together. They talk about his perimeter blocking. Maybe nobody in the country clears the way for his running backs like he does. But when you start putting plays like that together on film, you start climbing up that draft status because he's got the specs, he's got the touchdowns, he's got the swag. And you see the fumble there, the defense turning it over. Russo ready for it, motivating his team, as you heard our Chris Button say. And then he finished it off throwing to his guy. Matt, ring that thing.
On Memphis's first three turnovers, Temple settled for a field goal. On the last one, Temple tough. And it was Russo to Brandon Mack. Nine catches, matching a career high for Mack. 125 yards, just five off a career high in the receiving yards department. And that's a huge turn of events. A lot of time left. But four turnovers on the road, if you're Memphis, that's too many. This Temple defense has come up with big plays at the right time. And Anthony Russo was the key on that last drive, making the right reads, making the right plays. Fair catch is signaled. Memphis to the 25. Kevin Connors.
You know, Anish, we've been waiting all season for a major upset in college football. We have one brewing in Athens right now. Check out Israel Mukwamu picking Jake Fromm for the second time today. Ryan Helinski left the game with a leg injury. Dakarian Joyner is in. South Carolina up by 7 over on ESPN.
Wow. So Georgia, one of 16 remaining unbeaten teams on the ropes. And on that last kickoff, a fair catch was signaled, so Memphis has it at the 25, but there's a little loophole you could have taken advantage. If you catch that with 1 foot out of bounds, you get that at the 35. That's a kick out of bounds.
I'm not sure why he didn't let the ball bounce out of bounds. He nearly caught it on the sideline. That's crazy.
There's Gainwell. Makes his way across the 30. Well, even if he catches the ball with 1 foot out of bounds,
you're absolutely
it's the
right.
Same as a kick going out of bounds.
And he didn't even try to do that. And that's something you have a conversation with him. And we got a chance to talk to the special teams coach yesterday, Pete, and he was saying, you know, they've done a great job. You said it. They've been the second best team in the nation in terms of efficiency with special teams. They missed one there.
Still a lot of ball to be played. On second down, White to the air, steps up, under pressure, incomplete, chased by Diabate.
I'll give Brady credit. You know, at the times where the pocket has been blown up or this defensive line has gotten pressure on the outside edges, he's done enough today to keep the play alive. But can he now keep his team alive? You're down by 9. You started the game off poorly. You managed to get it going. Now's the time where you really take command of this team, this program, and you become Mike Norvell's guy. Show them something here that you can handle these types of situations and thrive.
Jones on the fly sweep with two tight ends and rumbles across the 40, a first down.
That's a great play call. And I've seen it a few times today from Mike Norvell. He just catches the defense off guard. You go to that ace formation, you bunch everybody in, they're thinking, oh, yeah, and he just completely duped the defensive end. DeAndre Kelly didn't even see that play coming, and he's supposed to keep contained. Great play call from Mike Norvell.
Memphis stays with the two tight end look. Poor snap. Gainwell still turns it in to almost a first down. He's something special, closing in on a 100-yard rushing and 100-yard receiving game. That has never been done in Memphis football history, and it hasn't been done by anybody in college football this season. He's up to 98 yards on the ground, has 100 through the air. White under pressure. He's got Coxey. And a first down inside the 40.
Great play there. And yeah, they go to the play action. After having some successful runs, that's when you can get into that package. And Brady White just does a good job of, after the fake, executing the throw. There was pressure in his face. And those are the types of plays you've got to make if you're going to be the guy here and keep this undefeated season alive.
Sixth 100-yard game of Coxey's career. White pumps, looking for Gibson, incomplete. Tyler broke it up. A flag is down at the 21.
holding, number 25, defense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot, first down.
Oh, that's just a costly penalty there from near Tyler. You can see the disgust on his face, and let's watch it through here. It's going to be on the left of your screen. It's a double move, and that often can get you, right? That you saw that pump fake there. That means they're going to run one route and then go somewhere else, and you can get duped on the outside edge if you're a cornerback.
White over the middle, Magnifico. Inside the 10. That's grown man football, first and goal, Memphis.
The adjustment they've made, they've gone to a bigger package. They put Brady White under center, and he's been able to operate. That time, play action again, and more success.
Joseph Dorsey is 94, the fullback. He is a D lineman, and he'll be the lead blocker. White into the end zone, caught for a touchdown. Tyce Daniel, the first reception of his career.
Brady White. I said it. This is the time. And boy, he didn't disappoint. This is what the coaching staff believes he's capable of. And they've been working on him with getting his footwork down and his throws. He has a tendency sometimes to have some lazy feet, and he's not always set when he throws. But I thought he's done a good job today making difficult throws, but also setting his feet.
Extra point is good by Patterson. They're going back and forth.
Yeah, they are.
Trading punches at the link. Temple looking to knock off its second top 25 opponent at home this season.
Nation.
September 14th, 21st-ranked Maryland came to Lincoln Financial Field. Terps had put up crazy offensive numbers through the first two games. Not the case against the Owls. Kenny Yeboah with a touchdown grab. And then Temple's defense with a huge goal line stand. This was about Temple tough. It was about effort. It was about the culture of this football team that started a decade ago. We're in the golden age of Temple football. It started with Al Golden. Steve Adazio continued it. Matt Rhule, a couple of 10-win seasons, and all built on the same foundation, toughness, being physical. Jeff Collins, he added a little tikka masala to it. But Rod Carey has come back in, and it's that blue-collar approach, and that plays well in this town. Temple will run this one out. They'll have it inside the 20. Connors.
Hey, to show you Texas every bit the heavyweight bout we expected. 2010 Sooners when Sam Ellinger punches it in. Jalen Hurts, 200 yards passing, 100 yards on the ground. 2017 and a Sooners on top.
Dicker the kicker, get ready.
Yeah, and these two kickers should also get prepared. Fourth quarter games, these are fun to watch. And for players, you know, it brings you together. And so, who's the more battle-tested team at this point? We're about to find out. Temple, though, as you mentioned, they've certainly built their program on toughness.
Gardner brought to the ground by Huff after a gain of 5. And for Temple, this is new today. They've worked with a short field for the large majority of this game. They haven't had to drive 80-plus yards.
Right. A lot of that had to do with the turnovers that Memphis was giving them and the position they were getting them on the field.
Five receivers on second down. Russo finds Isaiah Wright. DaVinci in cleats picks up a first down. The last 2 years, he has scored a touchdown in four different ways, receiving, rushing, punt return, kick return. A touchdown waiting to happen.
He's also a young man that's going to get a shot at the next level to play. He'll play on every special teams. And in the way that he's been used here and been unselfish, that'll certainly bode well for him at the next level.
Looking for Mack, it's incomplete. Jacoby Francis on the coverage. Russo has thrown in Mac's direction 12 times today. He's completed 9 of those passes.
That was a great angle there by Francis. He went to where the ball was going and not necessarily the wide receiver. That was the difference in him not getting a pass interference call and being there when the ball was thrown.
Empty again. There's the blitz. Russo has to throw it away, third down.
That was the defensive lineman. Dorsey is chasing down on the quarterback. Oh, man, he turned on the Jets.
Dorsey is a former walk-on. The walk-on program has been such a boon for both of these programs.
Anish, I don't know if you could beat this guy. Like, I mean, look at the big boy move now. That's big time. I don't know if I could beat him.
Memphis brings the blitz again. Isaiah wide open to midfield. A first down.
You heard me talk about Francis' angle to the football, and watch a poor angle to the football by Johnson. He's going to come underneath this. He goes to where the wide receiver was, and Russo with the outstanding throw in the middle of the field to get him a fresh set of downs.
Blue on the edge, shoved out by Francis. A gain of 5, second down.
And it's great when you get this type of pickup with this play, especially on first down, but it's also responsible for softening up the defense because it forces those defensive ends to hold when you run that jet motion. And whether he has the ball or not, that can create some spaces for your running backs to run in.
Ray Davis, tackled from behind by Blake. Third down coming up for Temple, and you're at the part of the field where if you don't get it here, you maybe think about going for it on fourth down.
Yeah, I mean, especially since they had success previously. So, but I think right here you go with another run, you try to get as close as possible, and then you rely on that offensive line to get some push. And win the game at the line of scrimmage. You want to talk about Temple tough? This is how you do it right here.
Isaiah Wright in motion. Play clock at 5. Ray Davis. And he's got the first down for Temple. Hasn't had his best game after back-to-back 100-yard performances. He and Jagger Gardner have provided those tough yards.
Yeah, frankly, he looks a little hobbled, but he's still making these types of plays. His cuts normally are a little sharper than that, but it was enough to get the first down and give credit to the offensive line that, as I said earlier on that last scoring drive, they really were doing a good job of getting out in front and winning.
Blue motions. Russo with time. He'll take a shot downfield. Incomplete. He overthrew Isaiah Wright.
This appears to be a double move, once again. So you're going to see the bottom of your screen. So it's called an out and up. What that does is you saw where Francis was duped. They won in coverage with a play call, and Russo misfires, or it would have been a touchdown. And you can see, right, he knows that that's the play they needed. That's the perfect play call, and they just didn't execute.
Gardner breaks a tackle and falls forward after a nice pickup. It sets up third down. Blake with the stop.
Gardner's also impressed me today. I mean, he's run physical behind his pads, and as big as he is, and when you're 6'2 and 220 and you run like that, you're hard to tackle. And there's always a home for you in an offense that's looking to run the football and to establish a sense of toughness with your rushing attack.
Gardner on the cutback. It'll be short. Fourth down. Will Mobley has hit 3 field goals today, including one from 44, a career long.
Now they're bringing in Davis. They're going to go for this. And Wow. I mean, I'm so impressed talking to Coach Carey and the way he's established this program. He's believing in his players. This will be on the ground, or they're going to go with a hard count. Whatever it is, if you're Temple and your coach puts the ball in your hands, make him right.
Blue motions. On the ground, Davis. Taken down at the 30. He's going to be short. Austin Hall with maybe a game-saving tackle. Davis is down. It's going to be Memphis ball.
Okay, and I said he's hobbled. This is what I mean by this. This is a play that Davis normally gets outside, and he wins this matchup. The push there was outstanding. As Tate gets in the middle of that, and the defense rallies around, ooh, big-time stop for the Titans.
AP rankings brought to you by Allstate. Georgia and South Carolina tied at 17. Oklahoma looking to finish off Texas. Florida, LSU, a big one later today. And heading further down, Michigan, only a 3-point lead on Illinois. Wolverines in the top 20. Memphis in the top 25 for the first time since 2017. Down by two with the ball from the 30. The Tigers have not led all game. Temple failed to convert on fourth down. And Kenny Gainwell now with 100 yards rushing and receiving. All purpose, like Kevin Connors.
Anish, Georgia down 17-10 at home. They called a penalty on fourth down, defensive holding, so the Dogs get it back. Jake Fromm to Demetrius Robinson. 17-17 game over on ESPN. South Carolina is driving, Anish.
4:41 to go in regulation. Again, thank you for bearing with us through those technical difficulties. Temple went for it on fourth down before Memphis took over, and this is why they went for it, because Memphis has been driving the ball almost at will since the start of the second quarter. Davis. Rather, Jones, excuse me, and he's out of bounds at the 44-yard line. Kadarian Jones, fifth-year senior from Big D.
Got to be careful in those types of situations. If you can get out of bounds, get out of bounds at that point. I mean, you've picked up the first down yardage. Don't give them a cheap turnover.
Gainwell, tripped up by Chappelle Russell.
That was a beauty. That was a great tackle, man. And he has not been easy to drag down today on the field, and Russell made that one look easy. Wrapped up those legs, that has racked up yardage all over the field today in a myriad of ways, and great tackle there from Russell.
And now Memphis milking some clock. Their kicker has great range if it comes down to that. Gainwell driven back after a gain of just a yard. Myjay again, and it's third down for Memphis.
Yeah, and that's something that Gainwell will learn. When you got guys like Myjay out on the football field, these aren't your normal cats. And so, sometimes you just got to get north and south, and he's a talented player. And this is the toughest matchup he's had all year long, and he's proven that he deserves to be on this stage. Does he get the touch here now? And listen, with the way that he's played, I put the ball back in his hands some type of way, whether it's a handoff or with a catch out of the backfield.
And a timeout by Mike Norvell with the play clock at one. We'll take 1-2. Huge third and 7 for Memphis. Temple's coaches talked to us about how Memphis uses angles in its running game. Explain, Ahmad.
Well, just see how they're shielding them off, and all it is a crease. When you're Gainwell, you just need a little bit of daylight to make a play happen. Watch the cutting ability here when he gets in behind. Wow, he's out. And for that reason, and he's in the backfield now with Brady White. Look, I go back to this young man. Look at the day he's having. He's been outstanding, one of the best running backs in the country.
On third and seven, White to the air. They'll check down. Gainwell canceled for a loss. Chappelle Russell, and now it's fourth down from the 43-yard line.
During the break, I said it. I literally said, this is what they should go back to, because they had success. They fake him the ball, and then they try to get him out right on the screen. This time, he's accounted for. The defense is like, uh-uh. They won on that play twice already in the second half, but Temple was ready for it. They pushed him back. It's a fourth and long situation. And if you're smart, you could also go for a pooch punch here and have them drive the length of the field.
White will throw under pressure. Has to get rid of it. Magnifico makes the catch for a first down. Living up to his namesake. Wow.
Amazing. Brady White throwing his off on his back foot with pressure and contact. They'll review this.
They look at this. Did he secure it? Did the ball hit the ground?
This play is under further review.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, that wasn't your typical Hail Mary. He threw up a prayer in the direction of 86, and that ball never hits the ground.
He caught that football.
Wow.
Great coordination. Nice job of Brady. He's literally got a defender hanging off his leg and throws that ball. Oh, my goodness.
I tell you what, Memphis has a couple of guys where the last name fits the player. Magnifico, the tight end, and Gainwell, the running back.
And they've both come up today with their fair share of plays. That was, you know, and Brady White doing what this coaching staff felt like he could do. But, you know, he's been given an opportunity. Your team's down. And these are the moments you live for if you're a true playmaker and you want to be the guy. Your team's down. You think about this. You watch Tom Brady come back in the fourth quarter. And you watch Drew Brees and all the greats. And you have an opportunity to reenact that. And Brady White, since I challenged him in that one drive, I said, this is on him. He has made the plays. He's looked very calm. He's done exactly what you would expect a guy that's on the rise would do.
And now if you're Temple, do you start using timeouts? Because Memphis has one of the best kicking games in the country. Riley Patterson, now you're comfortably within his range. So for Memphis, they don't need a touchdown. And you're close enough now for a field goal. So at what point does Temple start using its timeouts, hoping to maybe get the ball back?
I think it depends on what Carey does on the opposite sideline. Because listen, I mean, what Mike Norvell does. Because if you can put this ball in the end zone, put them away. Make them go and have to score a touchdown. You got the momentum. You said it. So why would you waste time? Maybe give them an opportunity on some kind of crazy play. You've got their foot on the throat right now. You know you got a kicker. That's in your back pocket. Let's take a chance here. I tell Brett, you either run the football, spread them out, thin them out in the box, give it to your guy, tell him you hold on to this football until the game's over, you know?
They've been looking at this for a long time.
I didn't see anything there, but they've got to make sure. This play was so big, and here comes the official.
After further review, the ball hit the ground before control. Incomplete pass. First down for Temple at the 43-yard line.
I didn't see it, but we're going to look at it again. We have to. Such a key moment in the game. I thought he hauled it in. Now, he does kind of bobble it at one point, but it doesn't appear as though it hit the ground.
And I'm with you, Mike. I do not see the ball hit the ground.
I see what they're saying, though. He doesn't have control. Watch when this ball jars on the ground. You can tell here he doesn't quite have control. And you see how it jumps.
Yeah.
So that is a great call. Thank you for the camera angle. That is what they were looking at. Now, and if he keeps that ball and it still moves, it can hit the ground. But that time it didn't appear as though he had possession in each.
From what we saw on our tiny monitors up here, it looked like that was part of his arm. And
yes,
again,
it did.
You go back to, is it indisputable video evidence to overturn it? The officials looked at that for a long time, and that got us wondering. And that call is reviewed. And now all Temple has to do is run out the clock. Memphis has two timeouts.
What What a change of events. Oh, my goodness.
You need indisputable video evidence to overturn the call. Initially, it looked like, was he juggling it? Yeah, but it never looked like the ball hit the ground.
Yep.
And we thought, hey, that looks like a catch. They looked at it for a long time, and that last angle that you saw for the officials and Edwin Leaves, the head referee in the replay booth, Jack Winter, that was enough to overturn. Ray Davis and Memphis will use a timeout. They've got one left. What a turn of events.
And what about these two juggernauts taking on each other here? The American is a strong conference. And I know for people that are watching at home and you're thinking, well, what is this conference all about? They've got three ranked teams, Memphis, Cincinnati, SMU, and Temple, Tulane. There are some other teams in this conference that'll go toe-to-toe for you. They've won games that they weren't even favored in. Now, the Mountain West Conference has also won. They won more games against non-conference opponents. However, the American, without UCF being as strong as they have been in years past, is as strong and as deep as they ever are, and Anish said it. But this conference deserves respect. And you know, their moniker, Power Six, it's hard as a guy. We cover the ACC, the Big Ten, the SEC, the Big 12, Pac-12. These guys belong, and these two teams here could handle any conference in the country.
Ray Davis and Memphis will have to use its final timeout. It's third down. Ahmad, you want to talk about where home field advantage comes in for Temple and the benefit of playing at an NFL stadium? So that last replay angle, which was the last one that we saw, we didn't see that while the officials were reviewing. You at home didn't see that. From what we saw, it was a catch. Well, that was from the Jumbotron.
Oh, my goodness.
That was from the in-stadium feed, and it was fed down to the officials here at an NFL stadium. They have access to it. And so talk about where does home field advantage come in.
You're totally right, Anish.
That was the camera angle that overturned the call, and Temple gets the ball back. And
amazing.
To make no bones about it, from that angle, it does look like the ball hits the ground.
Yeah, he doesn't have control here.
That's the only angle where it showed.
Watch when the ball hits the ground. It jars out.
Right there.
And it moves out. That's when you know you don't have control. Wow.
That was not from our feed. That was from the stadium feed. And that's why it was the last replay you saw at home. Third down. They'll hand it to Gardner. He's going to be taken down. And now Temple will run the clock down as far as they can. Memphis will get it back, but without any timeouts. So you can take this down inside a minute now.
We talked about special teams, them having the second most efficient and effective group in the country. When they do come back to punt this ball, I'm sending the entire house. And you, this is where you're expecting and hoping that someone can make a play and become legendary in a game that's already been a heavyweight fight.
Now, you keep going back to that replay, and the alarm bells, the longer it took, that was...
You're right.
Did they see something?
Well, that and then it's a fourth down call. I mean, so important.
Temple will let the clock run down to 53 seconds and take a timeout. They'll punt it away. Sports Center tonight after Florida LSU. Two unbeatens, both in the top 10. Certainly playoff implications, SEC implications. Michael Eaves, Kenny Mayne on the anchor desk. They'll have the live postgame news conferences with Ed Orgeron and Dan Mullen. Plus, the college football teams with the easiest path to the playoff. And baseball, Yankees, Astros, game one. Kevin Connors in the studio is going to be locked into that. Nationals, Cardinals, Washington up 1-0 after a dynamite pitching performance last night from Sanchez and Doolittle. Memphis has two return men. Temple has had issues with punts today. That's why LaFree has been handling the punting duties instead of Adam Berry.
They're coming after, no, they set up a return.
From the 15, a fair catch is made. And Memphis with 48 seconds.
That's a lot of time, Anish.
Has 84 yards to go.
That's a lot of time. And especially if you can win on the perimeter, you know, you either have to catch them off guard in the middle of the field, but most defenses are trying to protect the perimeter and down deep. You're going to see a three safety looks, perhaps. The corners will be off 7 to 8 yards. And you're being told to keep everything in front of you. And most importantly, tackle if they do catch it.
And remember, Memphis just needs a field goal. And they have a kicker who attempted a 55-yarder against Navy. He missed it, but he had the distance. Riley Patterson with a strong leg. In 2014, Memphis beat Temple on a Jake Elliott field goal as time expired. Elliott now plays in this building for the Eagles. White, under pressure, gets away from Roche, throws toward the sideline. The catch is made. The clock continues to run. It was shy of the first down marker.
He's Coxie. A big, strong kid. Shook off pressure a couple times today.
30 seconds and ticking. Magnifico over the middle. He's got a first down. Taken down at the 32. 19 seconds. The clock will momentarily stop. Memphis out of timeouts.
And if you're Bradley, you're a veteran. You got to hold him up. Don't throw him to the ground.
And the spike to stop the clock. 17 seconds left. You're probably thinking if you can get to the 40, Patterson has a chance. It might be a long chance. That's the outer limits of his range. But not much wind today in Philly. White steps up. Downfield, looking for Jones. 11 seconds left.
Miscommunication there between the wide receiver and the quarterback. Cut his route short and underneath. And Brady White was expecting him to extend the route, and he didn't. Now they're dropping numbers back. Now you play the game where you've got your linebacker Franklin back deep. No one should be inside a 7-yard marker when the ball is snapped.
White flushed. 5 seconds. Throws toward the sideline. Incomplete. There's 1 second left on the clock.
They've got to review this. I mean, it's that close. I don't know where his knee was at, but he appeared to have possession when he rolled back over. I don't know what happened in between. Let's have a look at it.
Travion Samuel was the intended target.
His knees are out. Yeah. He caught it, but he caught it out of bounds. Wow. Last play of the game, your undefeated season on the line.
Hook and lateral?
Why not? Why not?
Temple playing back. Over the middle. Now it's Coxie. He'll pitch it back to White. White's got to pitch it back. He will. And the ball game is over. Coxie erased by hand. Temple with another top 25 home win. And Memphis goes down for the first time this season. This season, the American from top to bottom is as good as it's been in its brief history. It's wide open. Today, another example. Down to Chris.
Coach, the first time you've been a ranked team twice in the same season. Congratulations. First, take me to that fourth down call as you're waiting for the review. What was going through your mind?
Well, initially live, I thought he caught it, and then I saw the review up there, and I go, no, he didn't. And so I was sitting there talking to the ref. We got word. We got the offense out, so pretty excited.
Your offense had a struggle trying to get it into the end zone, but when their backs were against the wall, they did. What does that say about the mojo of your offense?
We got a lot of resolve, and we got some tough kids, there's no question, and they didn't flinch today, which was really good. Now we got some things to clean up, but because we should have had more points than we did today. But you know what? You only got to win by one.
Yeah, congratulations. Go celebrate, Coach.
Hey, thank you.
Rod Carey's Temple Owls are 5-1. Memphis loses for the first time this season. They're back home next week against Tulane. It's a wild season and the American, a wide open conference with so many quality teams from top to bottom. You'll see another one coming up next. Cincinnati, a ranked team, on the road against Houston. Beth Mowins has the call.